Welcome to Pep Talk, Passion Equals Purpose. I'm Ann Richards, and I'm a life coach, among other things. So I'm so excited about my first episode of Pep Talk. My first guest is my friend, fellow yogi, Laura Ross. Laura Ross, along with her husband, Justin, own Cleveland Vegan, which is in Lakewood, Ohio, which is an exquisite all vegan restaurant. Welcome, Laura.
Hey, thank you. Good to be here. Hi, Ann.
Hi. So, real quick, if you're watching, you see Laura brought a beautiful cheesecake and a beautiful salad because I wanted you to see, if you can see, how lovely the food looks. Mm-hmm. And it tastes exactly like that. So, Laura, I want you to first tell us, where did you grow up?
I'm from New York City originally.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. My dad was from New York, and my mom's from Ohio. And so I grew up between New York and Cincinnati, and then went to college in Cleveland. That's how I got here. So, I'm from like a little hillbilly town in Cincinnati, and then New York City. So like two totally different worlds. Yeah.
I love asking people, and I inquire of my guests because I do feel like there's a thread. My belief is that passion, the passion extends mm-hmm. on a long journey. What was your favorite thing that you can remember to do as a child?
So when we were little, growing up, we always wanted to go to Florida or to the beach or a standard vacation. We never went on those trips ever growing up, never went to Disney World, never went to a beach vacation, but four times, we took 6-week camping trips out west in our station wagon with my three brothers and my mom's sister and her two kids. So there were six kids, and we went to probably almost every national park out west, and I've been to 37 states, and really traveling with my family and my brothers. My dad died when we were really little, so I think for some families that either can kind of sever some families' relationships, but for us it really brought us really close, even to this day. So
that's a lot of outdoor exploration.
A lot, yeah.
And I see that in you the way you are now, mm-hmm. I would say. Do you still have the same attachment to the outdoors?
Totally. Yeah, actually we're in the process of planning another version of a trip like that with all my brothers and now all of our kids, so it would be a much larger version
kind
of
like vacation.
Sort of, yeah. Like when I was, I think, 10 years old, we hiked to the bottom of the Grand Canyon.
That's amazing.
We were only going to hike to the first stop point, but we got there. They were like super fast, and then we could see the bottom and totally wanted to go. We convinced my mom. We had barely any water. We had no food because we were just going to go on this little hike.
Yeah.
And so we hiked all the way to the bottom. However, at the bottom, it's a desert. So we get to the bottom and we had to hike back up.
Get out. Yep. Survive.
We had to stop every 10 minutes. Some people gifted us food and water along the way, but we made it.
I'm looking for the thread as I am now. So I definitely see that quality in you and the quality of loving nature mm-hmm. and your peaceful self. And Laura also teaches yoga with me at Inner Bliss Yoga in Cleveland. And how did you discover, where did you find your yoga, passion?
I was in my early 20s, and probably like many people, I was going through a breakup and moved from Florida after college back to Cleveland just temporarily with some friends, and I was pretty depressed. And I remember being somewhere and I saw a flyer that said, depressed or lonely or, a couple
take
of
take some of these pills.
Take this yoga pill.
Wouldn't that be nice if there was a yoga pill?
Yeah.
But, I know what you're saying.
Some people might call something like that.
Yes.
Their own yoga pill. But, so I went and tried it. And the first few classes, I just cried, mm-hmm. for a long time after each experience. And I knew something was going on, so I just kept exploring it for a while.
Yeah.
And that's how it started.
So you felt sort of a healing, the process of healing, the process of releasing grief.
Yeah, absolutely. And then it started to spiral into healing a lot of things from my whole life, you know. Just my own childhood and my father's death, which I'd never really kind of dealt with until I got to that point.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's was the beginning, yeah. And then I just was so thirsty for anything, any experience I could find. I used to call myself a yoga whore. I know it sounds bad, but I went to every single yoga teacher in Cleveland, and you know, however many years ago, that was a lot more easy back then.
Yes.
There was not as many places to explore, but yeah, that's where it started. And then a few years later, I went through Bhumi's yoga teacher training.
Mm-hmm.
Bhumi's been around a long, long time.
Yeah.
Yeah, she's one of the first schools in the state of Ohio, and went through her program.
Yeah.
And started to go to different ashrams and yoga centers around the country, continuing that journey.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which,
yeah.
Laura's an amazing teacher, and it's obvious that you've studied a lot and practiced a lot. Growing up in New York, what was your first job?
My first job, well, was not in New York, but my first job was selling bridal dresses, actually. I worked.
That was your first job?
No one will believe it. Well, I didn't sell bridal dresses. I was a bagger. So I had to, I don't know if you've ever heard of this little town in Cincinnati. It's called Reading, and they call it the bridal capital of the world.
Oh, I never knew that.
And the largest bridal store is in this little tiny town, which is hilarious because it seems like two totally different worlds.
Yeah.
But it's called Bridal Informal. They have over 6,000 bridal dresses.
Okay.
And this is a little town. And I knew someone that worked there. And I got a job when I was 14. And I would just bag up dresses. So there were salespeople that would help people try on the dresses
in the
room. And then they would take the ones that the women didn't like, they would just kind of put them right outside on these racks. And we had to properly bag them and put them back. And then, you know, we had to know where they went. There's 6,000. You can't mess that up.
Right.
So I did that for about a year or so. And then on a really, really busy Saturday, I somehow got pushed into like helping a customer who wanted to buy a veil. She bought like a $1,500 veil. It was crazy to me at that time. But I made a commission on it. And I was like, whoa, this is really nice. And so then I kept saying, hey, I'll help. I know I'm young, but I'll help do that.
Yeah.
So when I was 15 or 16, I was their youngest bridal sales consultant.
That's cool.
So I did that all throughout high school.
Oh my gosh.
And then throughout college or when I came home.
So essentially you were selling.
I was selling bridal dresses, yeah.
And making money.
And I was making money, yeah.
That's cool.
And then I found a little boutique here in Cleveland when I went to college.
Which one?
Brides by Donna over in Chagrin Falls.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know exactly. On Main Street.
I emailed her and I said, I have this experience, and I ended up working with her really closely, and I went to bridal shows with her in New York City. And helped her. I went on buying trips with her.
Oh my gosh, this is killing me because this does not seem like you would be like a bride. Were you a bridezilla? What did you wear when you got married?
No, I was not a bridezilla. I wore a very simple silk dress. Just,
right?
Yeah.
Like the opposite of what you were selling.
Yeah, no, I was not. When I realized I wanted to get out of that world was I was checking out this mom and daughter, and they were spending a lot of money on this dress and veil, and they were, you know, the bride wanted a short veil and the mom wanted this like really, really long cathedral style veil, and it was uncomfortable. And so I'm writing up this veil. I was like, so do we decide? Do you want to wait on the veil? And the mom says, we're going to go with the cathedral veil. And then the daughter says, no, I don't want it. And she says, my mom had my wedding 30 years ago. When your daughter has your wedding, you can decide that.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just like, there was nothing to be said. And I was like, I don't know if this is where I want to be spending the rest of my, you know, life.
Yeah.
And actually at that time, she had, Donna, you know, who was older, had asked me if I wanted to buy this bridal store from her when I was 22, just out of college. So I declined, you know, very humbly. I was totally honored, but yeah, that was not where I was probably going to go with my life. But yeah, that's what I did for a long time. And then I bartended and worked in a lot of restaurants.
Oh, that's so
intermittently.
Cool.
I always have had like two or three jobs my whole life.
Yeah. And Laura is also big into meditation, like myself. I really practice it every day. It's an essential part of my life. And tell me about your journey with that, especially because a lot lot of people are intimidated about meditation.
Yeah.
And I try and tell people, like, you know, you start with a minute.
Yeah.
In quiet.
Yeah.
And see if you can be quiet for a minute. Yeah. And then maybe two. And then the next week, maybe five. That's how it is, right?
It's totally how it is. I remember hearing one time someone say to me that that meditation, or not, someone didn't say this to me, but I think there's this preconceived idea that meditation is your brain is supposed to just shut off and not think and not do. And I think it's so intimidating is because that is not the nature of what of the brain. The brain is actually mm-hmm. meant to think and to be inventive, and those that's, you can't undo what it naturally inherently is. I think the distinction, so when people go into it like trying to shut off their brain and then they can't because it's not actually possible, it feels frustrating.
Yeah.
Whereas I think if you go into it thinking, okay, here I am having thoughts, and I'm just going to sit here, even while that's happening, breathing, you know, doing practices that actually will help to relax your nervous system. And naturally, over time, this will be happening, but you're not even connected with over here. Like,
yeah.
Thoughts are going in, thoughts are going out. Maybe after some time, that slows down, like all of that happening.
Mm-hmm.
But you're not connected, you're just letting whatever is happening, and you're still sitting.
That's
so
a great
that,
way of looking at it.
Has been so helpful for me. But probably maybe close to 10 years into me practicing yoga, and then I actually had already been teaching. I don't want to call it a stale point, but I did get to a point where I was really searching, and you know, I read these beautiful books on spirituality and yoga, and I'd have an experience from reading the words on the pages, like, wow, that sounds awesome, you know, like being at one with yourself and
yeah.
not being fearful and all these things that we're all yearning for. But I found myself not, I wasn't really living my life that way. I mean, yoga had definitely changed me, and you know, I was a good person and all of those things, but I didn't feel like at the core that that was really, you know, the words I was teaching to other people wasn't always how I was experiencing my life.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So I didn't, you know, I didn't want that anymore. But at the same time, one of my friends in New York City, who's married to my cousin, we're very, very close. We've been to yoga centers and ashrams all over the country. About a year or two prior to that, she had started practicing this daily meditation. It's called Isha Yoga. And I saw her a holiday, and I said, what's going on with you? Something has totally changed. And she said, I've been doing, you know, this meditation. And so I just took note of it. And a year passed, and again, I personally seen such a huge dramatic change. She had always been very depressed, a lot of anxiety, and even like some drug and alcohol issues, and a lot of that just started to fall away. And then I got to this point where I was feeling really stale in my own experience, so I looked into it. So yeah, I took a program, it's called Inner Engineering, and learned a practice, it's called Shambhavi Maha Mudra. It's a 21-minute, very simple meditation and some breathing practices. And it's the first time I've been able to really do anything like that every single day.
Yeah,
so
you're
for the
very
last,
committed.
For the last 10 years, that's been I strongly believe, both me and Justin, that Cleveland Vegan wouldn't even have happened. Maybe we wouldn't still even be together. There's many things that is supported. It's just
yeah.
supported ourselves individually and then in everything that we've done. People ask me all the time, how do you do it all? You have three kids and you're teaching still? Like, how do you still teach? And you have this business?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
for me, it does not feel that. I mean, it feels very full and it's jam-packed. And there are days where it's a little too much. So I'm not like totally super. I'm not superhuman. But I wake up every day at 4:30, 5. And
is that when
practice.
You do the meditation?
Yeah.
First thing.
First thing, as soon as I wake up.
Before your kids are up.
Before they get up.
Crawling around.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we both can get up at the same time. And sometimes they interrupt us, and that's okay too.
Yeah.
But it's always in the morning. There's no way to get it in.
Right.
Our days are just full.
Yeah.
Till the moment I pass out.
Do you go to bed at like 9, 10?
Right when they go to sleep, almost.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm committed this year to reading novels again.
Yeah.
So I'm trying really hard to do that. So once they go to sleep, I'm starting to read again. I'm reading a Stephen King book right now. Totally nothing like what I normally read, but it's really good.
I read a really good book that I loved called Where the Crawdads Sing.
Mm.
I think you would love it.
Is it a fiction book?
Yeah. And I'm like
that's
you.
That's what I'm seeking out.
I have forced myself back into fiction.
Yeah.
Because I've read so much spiritual reading.
Yeah.
And I love it.
Me too.
But at the same time, sometimes I need a really simple,
yeah,
let's go to sleep,
yeah,
easy.
Yeah.
And that's what I like to do right before bed.
It takes you away a little bit. Probably about 10 years ago, I saw the first Harry Potter book. I don't know where
yeah.
I was. And someone was giving away a bunch of books. And I never read those books. This huge phenomenon about Harry Potter. So I grabbed the first Harry Potter book, you know, 20 years after it came out probably,
mm-hmm,
and I read it, and I just fell in love with it. I read all of the books.
You did?
And it is, well, the story is just,
it is
so amazing. And I'd seen some of the movies, but that was kind of my entrance back
into fiction.
Into fiction.
Yeah.
And then I was there for a while, and then I started having kids, and then I've not read a book
so
like that.
So Laura has three kids. What are their ages, Laura?
Eli is 6 and a half, and Simone's 4. And the baby Hugo's too.
So I agree. I'm one of those people who looks at Laura and says, "Oh my gosh, how is she doing this?" I go to Cleveland Vegan. She's there working behind the counter. I take her yoga class. She's amazing. And then I know in the background of all of that, as a mother of three myself, there is that whole background that most people don't know what's going on a daily basis, which. I mean, my kids are way older than that, but I still talk to them every day. There's still always something every day with everyone. But, I mean, I love it. Your ages, though, it's a care and nurture.
Yeah.
And all you have going on. And it is amazing how you do it so peacefully.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say that is definitely a result of the morning meditation, the practice of inner engineering, which now you follow, this guru, Sadguru.
Sadguru, yep. Yeah.
Yeah, that's my next thing.
Yeah.
Inner engineering,
yeah,
and then go to the ashram.
Yeah.
I can't wait.
Yeah.
Does the ashram have wine, Laura?
No.
The reason I ask is because, you know, I have to give my little...
Or coffee. Yeah, I know. That one
I just did 15 days no coffee.
Yeah.
And let me tell you, 15 days was rough.
Yeah.
However, wine only because my yoga retreat is in Italy in September.
Yeah.
And if you like wine and yoga and the
go.
Beautiful hills of Tuscany, you must join me and check that out at AnnRichardsInspires.com. The trip is called Vino and Vinyasa, and it is for all levels of yoga, or perhaps even if you have never done yoga, you would still love it. So check that out for
Tuscany.
Me.
Tuscany.
Yeah.
Amazing.
So did they have food like this at the ashram?
Yeah, so all of the food is vegetarian, mostly vegan. They use a little bit of milk and honey and things. But yeah, the food is absolutely amazing. It's Indian inspired, but it's so clean, and there's such a certain way in which they prepare foods.
Mm-hmm.
We call it Isha food, me and my husband, because we love Indian food, and we've been to India, and there's no food like
this food.
No, there's no food like this.
So I should go maybe for the food.
Both, yeah. Well, it depends on what program you take. Certain, like, really intense programs, they feed you a very simple
mm-hmm.
diet, so you're not going to get the rich, amazing food.
Right.
So it depends. But, yeah, so there's the original ashram is in Coimbatore, India. It's in southern India, and that's been around since, I think, the 60s. 70s, and then this ashram is in Tennessee. It's about an hour and a half from Nashville, and that is, you know, been around for maybe 15 or 20 years. 20
so
years, probably 20 years.
Tell us what we have here.
Mm-hmm.
If you're watching us, you can see it. If you're listening, Laura will explain
yeah.
the salad.
So we call it our kale Caesar salad. We massage the kale in a little bit of coconut oil,
mm-hmm.
and then there's the vegetables. There's cucumber, tomato, carrot. And then there's blackened tempeh. So tempeh, if you're not familiar, it has a lot of protein. It's a fermented soy product, really good. It's not very processed at all. And then on top, there's cashew parmesan. So you won't miss your cheese. And then it comes with, which is not showing, but a creamy cashew-based Caesar dressing. So pretty traditional Caesar, but a lot healthier.
And this is on your menu now.
It's on our current menu, and our menu shifts. It changes every few months or so with the seasons, but yeah.
And this is delicious. I always tell people you would never know most of the food is vegan. It just tastes good.
Yeah.
That's why it's great. It's just good food. Yeah. I took my son there. He's a complete carnivore.
Yeah.
And he liked it.
Yeah.
It's not as if it has to be. I mean, he just liked the food.
Yeah.
It wasn't.
I mean, vegan is in the name, so it's pretty obvious. But other than our name being Cleveland Vegan, we don't really promote that. I mean, the food is just as good.
Yeah.
It's kind of.
However,
yeah.
The funniest is the sign that says, yes, everything is vegan, which I laugh at, but I totally, as soon as I saw that, I'm like, oh, I know why that's there.
Yeah.
Because people come in, I'm sure they're like, well, is this vegan? And is that vegan? And
yeah.
You're like, listen, we're Cleveland Vegan.
Yes. Yeah, well, I mean, especially when people walk in, they see our bakery case, and it's filled with decadent
like
treats.
Like this!
Like the things that people are used to eating,
and cookies and scones
and bars,
donuts,
and cakes, donuts.
Those are all so tempting.
So good.
What is this one?
So this on the bakery side would be on the healthy spectrum. This is our raw cheesecake, and we do a variety of flavors. But this one here is a blackberry vanilla and matcha cheesecake. The crust, so it's gluten free, raw, obviously vegan. It's also sugar free. It's just sweetened with dates in the crust, dates and walnuts. And then there's a little agave in the cheesecake part, which is cashew-based.
Can we cut this?
Yeah.
This,
I wanted to bring this slice because it looks sort of really pretty.
Like, I know.
Yeah.
It's so pretty.
Cut on into it.
I think we'll leave it for Cody, who works here and helps us because
he's
so good. And he also loves your Cleveland Vegan.
Mm,
yeah, we'll
so
leave
sweet.
It for all the people here at ESPN.
Thank you.
I'm going
to
try
this
because... I can't help myself looking at it. I'm sitting here with my mouth watering. Oh my gosh, it's kind of messy. Now, do you still, like, do you look at this and go, I can't wait to try that? Or are you, like, get sick of food?
I go back and forth sometimes, yeah. Usually Daniel, who's our head baker, he's amazing, but he'll usually bring me little things, like, when he's tasting stuff. So
mm-hmm.
I get my sweet fill all the time.
Yeah.
I never go out and say, oh, cut me a slice of that, guy. Because I save it, you know, I want everyone else to enjoy it. It's usually like little taste intermittently throughout the day that I'm trying.
This is amazing.
When he brings stuff in.
I've never had this, and I will tell you, this is amazing.
Yeah, they're good.
So Daniel the baker does your pastry, and he just comes up with these.
Yeah, so he's a traditional pastry chef.
Mm-hmm.
That's his background, and he started working for us a few years ago. We didn't even have a bakery department or a bakery menu. We had like a few, you know, bakery offerings.
Yeah.
And so he came and just was working for us very part-time and was decorating cakes because he's very good at that.
Mm-hmm.
From there, we realized how good he was, how efficient he was. He was really comfortable in a commercial kitchen. And we thought that we probably could expand and have a fuller bakery offering. And so we snatched him up from where he was working. We said, hey, do you want to run our bakery? You want to
mm-hmm.
start out? And so he said yes, thankfully. And so since then, he's taken, you know, little by little. You know, we had a base of recipes at that point that
mm-hmm.
he could start with. So it wasn't like but then he's like, you know, I love making croissants. They're so good. That'd be great for the morning. Okay, great. Figure out how to make that.
So no
vegan.
Butter.
No butter. Vegan butter.
Okay.
You
know,
so he makes like a traditional croissant pack, if
mm-hmm.
you're familiar. And there's lots of vegan butter. So
yeah.
We use Earth Balance. Croissants, and then, you know, the next thing was just
so
all different types of things.
I know that your business has gone big into weddings.
Yeah. Well,
so does he do like big vegan wedding cakes?
Oh yeah.
And they're the same, like people request usually what?
Full, I mean, like tiered wedding cakes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah. He does. Full
and they
service.
Say vegan.
Yeah. Some weddings we cater. One of them may just have a dairy allergy, so they're not even vegan, and they have meat at their wedding. Has nothing to do with that, but they need, you know, the bride wants to be able to eat her wedding cake, so they need something vegan. So people come to us for a variety of reasons.
Yeah,
it's not. Sometimes it's just an allergy based. So we're discovering that there's, you know, many people that can't have dairy and can't have gluten, and it's almost impossible to find a bakery that can make cake that is vegan and gluten free.
Yeah,
maybe one or the other. Maybe not always good, but you might be able to find it, but to find both of them. So that's been kind of a niche market. We had no idea that that would happen. But yeah, no, so we do full, we're a full service catering company. That's actually how we got our start. So we cater huge events, and we do weddings.
This is delicious.
Yeah.
So you met Justin, okay, and then was he, or were you both into food or eating healthy, or?
No. Not really, yeah.
And was he still really into his music?
Yes, yeah, so when I met Justin, my husband, we've been together for almost 12 years? Yeah, or 10 years, 11 years, something like that. Yeah, he's been playing music since he was 5. He's a full-time musician when I met him. He was attracted to the fact that I think I was a yogi and I was a vegetarian at the time and always said he wanted to eat healthier. So that just naturally, I think, started with him. And then a couple of years later, when we moved in together, he stopped eating meat. And that was on his own sort of accord. But no, he actually is the chef and the food person.
Yeah.
He worked at his uncle's restaurant downtown.
Okay.
And then a few years later, his friend opened a catering company and needed Justin to start. So Justin always needed jobs that would let him also then go on the road for weeks at a time. So hence working for his uncle and then working for his friend, both of which allowed him to work when he was there and then also take off for a while. So that's just natural. He didn't plan to go into the food business. He just was there because those were jobs he could get.
Yeah.
And then he really loved cooking. He really got into it. And then we became vegetarian and then slowly became vegan, kind of just through my kind of yogic path. But and then it became sort of like
were you cooking at home?
Yeah.
Vegan?
Yeah, so Justin was. So, I eat granola and cereal and salads and hummus, really simple eating.
Yes.
And he's like, listen, I will eat this way, but not this way, not the way you're eating. So I'm going to cook food.
So he decided to take it up a notch.
Yeah, he took it up a notch and was like, all right, I'd love to eat this. How can I make this vegan? And it became like a game to him and an experiment. And it really opened up his creative side. And then Cleveland Vegan sort of came. The band he'd been with for a very long time stopped, they broke up, and then he was like, okay, well now I don't have to work for a place and lets me leave for weeks at a time. I can really do what I want to do now. And he came home one day, I was like, I don't want to chop up cases of chicken anymore. And I was like, okay, well, what do you want to do? And then he's like, I want to start a vegan catering company, which I did laugh at first. I was like, what, really? What are we don't know how to run our own business. And he just kept kind of saying it, like nudging me here and there.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, so then what would be the first thing we would do? And he's like, I would make a menu. I'm like, okay. So he created this little menu, and then I was like, let's cook all the dishes. And we just did it was a very organic unfolding. A friend of ours offered to put a menu together and make it look nice, and then another friend started a little website for us. Another friend designed the logo, all of it for nothing. And
isn't it amazing? Yeah, I feel like when you're on your path and you are doing what you're supposed to be doing, everything flows in the direction because you found it.
Yeah.
So everything just flows and goes, and all those people and things just easy, right?
What you need is just
there. Did you feel that way, or was there an element of fear?
There was a little bit, but for the first time in my life, I really release myself of a lot of that.
Yeah.
And I was like, it might work, it might not, and that's okay.
Yeah.
And then once I released myself of like letting it go or not working or not working, then it just became really fun. And we didn't even plan for it to work. It was really just going to be a side project for Justin. Maybe that's why I wasn't afraid, because what was I going to be afraid of? We were just trying something out. I was working at a nonprofit organization at the time.
Yeah.
Doing that, teaching yoga. I didn't really think Jess would need my help, but just for little things here or there. And then it exploded just so quickly. And
so when it started and it moved really fast, was it overwhelming?
Yes, because I was also, I had just had our first kid. So, so when I was pregnant with Eli, we were putting Cleveland Vegan together, like behind the scenes, like what this little catering business would look like. And then...
So you're birthing two babies.
Yeah, we birthed two babies. And we bought a house, and so there's all this happening. And so I quickly had to jump in and start hiring staff and figuring out how to run the business. Justin's specialty is not, responding to emails and managing and hiring. Like, being a musician your whole life, you... don't ever have to do that sort of thing. And so I had that experience. So we came together. And then it just has been super fast from there. The friend that we, that let him have the job at this, at the catering company, that's where we rented space for the first year and a half. And then, about a year in, he said, if your business grows anymore, you have to get on out and find your own place. So we, that's where our current location came from.
It's in Lakewood and Detroit. What's the address, Laura?
17112 Detroit Avenue.
And you just expanded.
Just expanded, yeah.
And what are your hours again? Please share.
Tuesday through Friday, 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. Saturday, 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. And Sunday is 9 to 3. We're closed on Monday.
And tell me when it's not busy. Because it's busy.
Busy. Yeah, so during the week, during the, you know, Tuesday through Thursday, anytime is fine to come in. Yeah. Morning, you can come in for. And I guess the least busiest time would be a weekday morning. Would be weekday morning.
Yeah.
For breakfast. Lunch, we get a definite lunch crowd, but it's never too full where you can't get a table. The same thing with the night. It's, you know, we now have 17 tables. I mean, before we had 10, and we filled that up really quick. So now we have more capacity, but it might be busy. But the weekends, we're very busy. Yeah, Saturday and Sunday.
What's your favorite item on the menu? Mm-hmm.
Right now, we have a mushroom toast. If you like mushrooms, people, you like it or don't. So it's a multi-grain bread, and then it's almond ricotta spread on the bottom. And it's, that alone is just phenomenal.
Heaven.
Yeah, so we make our own ricotta cheese with almonds, and then it's mushrooms on top. Seasoned.
Delicious.
Mushrooms. Very simple, a little green onion on top.
Do you
it's
ever,
one of my favorite dishes.
Not that you're going to say it out loud. Do you ever cheat? You ever eat anything that's not vegan?
No, I mean, there are times where if I'm like in the middle of eating something and then I find out it has honey or it has a little something in it, I'll just continue eating it depending on where I'm at.
So you never cheat?
Not really, no.
What about your kids? Are you raising them vegan?
Yeah, since they've been eating this way since birth, it's not even like a thing for them.
Right.
However, with Halloween, it's tricky. Now our oldest, you know, they go trick-or-treating, they have all this candy, half of it's not vegan, so, you know, and they know vegan or not, you know, but, so my son last year was going through it, putting all the stuff that we don't eat aside, and then he's like, I really want to eat, you know, like these Snicker bars, and I get it, I want to eat them too.
Right.
So I said, you can eat them, you know, so now at the point he's six, you know, we don't want to demonize anything. The sure way for him never to want to eat this way is if we tell him you can't ever, you know.
Yeah.
So we tell him it's his choice.
Yeah.
You know what we're gonna buy is a certain thing, but you know when you're out,
it gets trickier.
Yeah.
And longer
so he ate one of them, and he was kind of hiding it from me, and I was like, listen, buddy, you don't have to hide it. You just eat it. If you want to eat it, you eat it. It's fine. But just know your system doesn't eat it very much. You're not gonna feel good. You know.
Yeah.
I think it's also too hard for him to know that it comes from an animal. Because it just looks like a piece of chocolate.
Yeah.
Like eating a piece of meat for him is a little different. Like he's
sure.
Like, I don't want to eat that. Like that's a, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
We were at my family's a few weeks ago and we ordered two pizzas, one without cheese and one just regular. And he really wanted what his cousins were eating. And he was kind of just sheepish about it. I was like, listen, just go get a piece of pizza, you know, no big deal.
Yeah.
And so he did. And halfway through it, he came over and was like, I really like the cheese. So take it off. So. That's going to be our approach just because, you know,
yeah.
I mean, I was a kid. Anything my mom told me not to do is what
you
I wanted
did.
To do. So,
yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Is the pizza gluten-free, right?
No. Oh, no, we can eat regular pizza, just the cheese.
The
cheese. But now there's amazing vegan cheeses. Just not all restaurants have that. So,
right.
Yeah, there's, you know, Follow Your Heart, we think is the best. They have a Follow Your Heart mozzarella cheese.
Ooh.
It melts just like regular cheese.
Okay.
You know, I don't think you would know the difference. I mean, maybe if you eat cheese a lot, you would, but it's been away from me for a while, so when I eat it, it's amazing. Yeah.
I think it's a lot to run a business with a partner, a spouse especially, and then be a parent together and business together. It's a lot. What would be, you know, the biggest challenge with that?
Having time for ourselves.
alone, like separately?
You know what? Both. We actually, it's strange. So we're together all day. We wake, we start the day, we meditate together at the beginning of the day, but we're not really together. You know, like we get up, we're quiet, we go in there together, and then it's like the storm of our children, getting them ready. It's like an Olympic sport to get out on time every day.
Yes.
And then we get to work, and we're together, and we're managing, but going back and forth. And he's doing different work than I am,
but
you know, we're ebbing and flowing together with millions of questions throughout the day. But it's nothing personal. It's nothing, you know, it's hard for us to even have a moment together. And then it's who's picking up the kids, and then the whole rest of the night. And then we're both so tired. So we find that we need a break from each other. However, we also need to be together. Because, like, really together, not just in all those ways, as a parent, as a business partner, and, you know, having a home together. And so it's an interesting struggle that, you know, I want a break from you, but I also know I need, you know, that's probably my
guess. And as long as you can communicate that, it really helps.
We say it out loud. We don't always have a solution there, but we know that it's something, you know, that we work on. But, you know, we do. Last week we went and got a steam and a massage together, and we spent the whole afternoon. And so we make the space for it, even when it's hard to do it. Like, you know, I felt really pulled, but I just forced myself to do it.
Yeah.
And then it was lovely and nice. So, it is. That's challenging. We do have a director of operations at Cleveland Vegan who is, it's like me, Juliana, and Justin, the three of us. And she can attest to, you know, she'll oftentimes come in between. Or if him and I can't agree, we'll go to her and she'll, you know, she can make a decision.
She's like the counselor.
Yeah. Or she just, you know, we trust her
100%. Her opinion.
Yeah. So many times, you know, we'll just go to her about things. Or me and her can just discuss something and then she can go to him. It's not like it's just me and him up here on the top, and there's a lot, you know, that's happening.
Yeah.
A lot of people in place.
Were you ever in a point where you thought maybe we can't do this? Did you ever get to the point where you're like, you know what, it would be so much easier if we just stopped right now?
Cleveland Vegan.
Yeah.
There are moments, you know, the hardest thing about having your own business is, are the people, you know?
Yeah.
You mean the
people that you hired?
Yeah, having staff is hard.
Yeah.
So we have 35 employees now, and that part is tricky, you know, just
35.
Having so many people.
Whoa.
We haven't gotten to that point, but we do talk about our end, and I think that's an important thing for anyone, to always know where you want to be going.
Your end game.
Your end, yeah, it's really powerful.
It's very smart.
And me and Justin are like, okay, we don't want to do this forever, you know, and I think it's good, too, because people you can get so attached to everything that you're doing.
Yeah.
And even the most beautiful thing, like for us right now, Cleveland Vegan, even this, you know, it will be good to, you know, pass over. We don't know for how long we'll do it, but we know what we want to do next. So,
can you say?
Yeah, we want to have a vegan a bed and breakfast. So, yeah, go right back into another business. Hopefully that won't be as intense.
Okay, but maybe like
chill.
Somewhere else? Like,
yeah, so when our kids are a bit older, mm-hmm. and in a more seasonal place, like we're thinking like maybe a college town,
mm-hmm.
that's so busy during the school year, and then summers we can either not be there, or like our family can come and stay, or help whenever they want. You know, and I can teach yoga and help run the business. Hopefully that wouldn't be as demanding as what we're doing. And then Justin could keep to the grounds and the garden, which he really loves, and do the food. So it's kind of going in the direction of what we love to do. So that would be like a scaled down version. And plus, when we travel, we love to go to B&Bs, but again, the hard thing is
food.
The food that they serve, the breakfast, is not vegan.
No.
So
you're getting continental breakfast.
Yeah.
Toast, jam.
Yeah. And then everyone else give these great, you know, amazing omelets and whatever they're cooking, and waffles and pancakes and things that we can make vegan style.
But, yeah.
And when you Google vegan bed and breakfast, there are not. There's
wow.
Nothing.
What a
country.
Niche.
You know?
The whole vegan thing is so hot now. I mean,
they're saying it's the year of the vegan, 2019.
Oh.
Although I thought last year was, because the amount of growth that we saw in 1 year, not just in our numbers, but in the demographics of people coming into the restaurant, just the different age groups, socioeconomic backgrounds, race, ethnicity, blew my mind. Age groups.
So this year might even double that.
Yeah, we'll see.
It's the, you know, the Chinese calendar, it's the year of the pig.
Ah. year of
but
saving
the year
the pig.
Pig might
the
be
year
very
the pig.
It might be a very good year for you.
Yeah, we'll see. I don't know if we can sustain much more growth. We're actually kind of hoping it sort of levels out.
Because it's just
way.
So busy.
Yeah, well, so we just expanded in October, so we know we're not at the peak yet. So we're still like it's still like going like this. But
yeah.
I'm hoping that at some point we can get to a point. All right, this is how many staff we need to run it. People might leave and stuff, but we know what it takes to run.
Yeah.
The hard thing is the catering. We have to decide how busy we're gonna let that keep getting or not.
Yeah.
Which is something that is within our control, which is nice. How many people walk through the door? That's we can't ever control that.
Exactly.
And that's what's been exploding so much.
Yeah. So unpredictable.
So unpredictable. And I'm, I'm not complaining. It's beautiful that it's happening. But the catering, we can turn down things and we can monitor.
Yeah.
That manageable. Like only take a certain amount of events per month.
When you go out. Especially in Cleveland, is
yeah.
there anywhere that you like to go?
To eat?
Yeah.
Yeah, we have our favorites. We love to go to Thai Spice. It's in Westlake. Our kids love it. They eat the lemongrass, tom yum soup, which is really spicy.
Yeah.
All three of our kids, including our 2-year-old.
Love that spicy food.
They love spicy food, yeah. So that's one of our favorite spots. They do it all for us vegan. They know us. Aladdin's is an easy go-to place. There's so much there we can get. That's in our rotation, and then we'll go to Dewey's Pizza, and you can bring your own toppings for people that may
you're
not
kidding
know that.
For pizza.
It's crazy.
I never knew that, and we've gone to Dewey's forever.
You can bring your so we'll bring our. They don't have vegan cheese they put on, but we
they
can
will?
Bring a bag of vegan cheese, and we'll bring our own like homemade seitan like or something that would be like a meat substitute.
Yeah.
And just in a container,
and they'll do it.
They'll put it on your pizza.
Oh, that's amazing.
So we'll go there. The kids like that.
Yeah, because they can watch them make it.
Yeah, and then
it's
with
cute.
Me and Justin are going out separately without the kids.
Yeah.
Forage is a great spot. They have
a
ton of vegan options on their menu. We like to go to Lux.
Do you still go out do you still go out dancing?
Sometimes. I'm going to Justin's playing music tomorrow night, so I'm going to see him play.
Are you?
Yeah.
Wait, he's playing again, or is he every
piano.
So often? Every so often
you know,
he'll play?
He's, over the last 6 months, he's starting to play a lot more.
Really?
And collaborate. Yeah, he's playing with a group again next week, and they're a really fun group, and so, yeah.
You're going tomorrow night to see him?
Yeah, he's playing tomorrow night at Brothers from 6 to 8.
Yeah.
Piano.
In the piano bar.
Yeah, in the piano bar. It's
how
so
awesome.
Much fun. So this will be his second time back. He's playing once a month.
What will he play tomorrow night?
He calls it the saddest happy hour.
Oh my god, I have seen that. Yes. And I thought that's hysterical.
It is hysterical. So it started off you would play a lot of Tom Waits songs. So if you know Tom Waits
it's pretty sad.
Yeah, he'd be pretty sad. But Justin loves Tom Waits and so do I,
Okay.
He has to be in the right set mind for it. But,
yeah.
So he plays some Tom Waits, but then he also plays, John Prine to really uplifting, beautiful music too. It's
oh my gosh.
A bit of both.
I have
but
to go.
It's really fun. So,
yeah,
so he's starting to play music again more, and I'm starting to read again, so there's like a little bit of life coming back.
Yeah, there's some light coming back in.
Yeah, yeah.
I was going to ask you about music, because I love music, and I love talking to people about their wide variety of tastes, which
and
I
we
would
have
say.
Someone in common that we love.
Let's see. Well, Bruce Springsteen.
Yes.
We both love and adore.
Yes.
And I told you the whole story. I went and saw him live on Broadway because I won lotto tickets, which is the power of intention, I'm telling you. Because
when I saw that you were there, I was like, I knew that Anne would be at the show. It's the weirdest thing. And then I saw his picture. Well, there's Anne at the show.
Right?
I knew she was going to be there.
I made that happen.
Yeah.
I totally manifested that because the tickets were so expensive.
Yeah.
And when I found out about the lottery, I was like, I'm going to win that lottery. And I played all the time. I played the nights I knew I could get to New York the next day. And the last time I could get there is the show that I won.
Wow.
It was the last time I could have gone. And then he was closing.
Wow.
And so we drove up.
Wow.
My tickets were $75 a piece, which they were going for up to, $3,000. It was the most, I wish you could have seen it. And
yeah.
And although it's on Netflix, you have to watch because it was, for me, an epic experience, and I've seen him live in concert, but this was really special. And I also love the music you play, more like the Grateful Dead, Creedence.
Yeah,
those are like your that's like your
all
wheelhouse.
Music before I was born.
It is.
It was around when I was born. But I love that. My dad was a Grateful. My dad was a musician. My dad was a guitar player. So it's, I guess it's not strange that I ended up with another musician, but he followed the Grateful Dead along with my mom for years. And
they did?
That was the music I grew up with. So I didn't grow up listening to
pop
music.
No.
I grew up listening to that. And my brothers all went and saw the Grateful Dead.
Yeah, so it inhabits your soul.
Yeah, when I was 13 years old, my brother came back. It was the last time that Grateful Dead came through Ohio. I was like, glad to see the Grateful Dead. For my 13th birthday, he gave me American Beauty, which is a pretty classic Grateful Dead album. And then he died like a month or two later. So
your
never,
brother?
No.
Oh, Jerry Garcia. Jerry. I'm like, wait a minute, whoa.
No,
so you didn't
see him. I didn't
see him. Oh,
so, no, but so yeah, so I grew up with all that sort of music, and I love it. And then I met Justin, who, you know, also was in a band that was playing just music inspired from not the Grateful Dead, but maybe CCR or even Bruce. They used to cover a couple of Bruce songs, which were a lot of fun.
Yeah.
So
there is definite that attraction. Is, you know, you grew up like that.
Yeah.
So comforting, right?
So comforting, yeah.
And now the Cleveland Vegan, and we can't wait to follow the next steps of you guys. It's amazing what you're doing. And here in Cleveland, I mean, I went to a couple of vegan restaurants with my daughters in New York, which were good.
Yeah.
But I do think yours is better.
And
I think in New York, it's such a trend.
Yeah.
Everyone is there taking pictures on their Instagram about, because they're there. It's the school spots.
Yeah.
Which is wild.
Yeah.
It's like the cool place to be is the vegan restaurant.
I know. It's wild.
So good for you, because the timing was definitely right. But it's passion.
Thanks.
It's not cool. It's what it is.
We didn't know if anyone would come.
So I'm telling you,
pretty excited.
You have got to go check out Cleveland Vegan and online.
Thank you.
Right?
Yeah, clevelandvegan.com will get you to everywhere.
So if you want a wedding, you want catering, which I think you should look at.
Or cake or anything like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can follow us on Instagram. That's where we have a lot of our, you know, content. But
yeah,
Facebook.
It's been wonderful talking with you.
I love talking with you.
And I want you all to remember that if you need some talking, call me or message me or go to my website, AnnRichardsInspires.com, and send me an email, especially if you have any questions about what we have been talking about, or you have a question about your life's path and the direction that you want it to go, and maybe you're feeling a little bit stuck, which a lot of people are at one time or another, and I'd love to help you out with that. So please keep on listening, and we'll talk to you at the next podcast. Have a super day. Bye.